You were born with a grace.
The gift that looks good on you.
That grace is your gift.
The gift that looks good on you.
It's a divine enablement.
The gift that looks good on you.
If you work your grace, the grace will work for you. Company, teach the lesson.
Satan chapter 11.
How about you
status of prayer. It's just you understanding the importance of prayer. One scripture, can you read it with me? One day Jesus was praying in a certain place, and when he finished, one of the disciples said to him, "Lord, will you teach us to pray?" Just as John taught his disciples. You may be seated in the presence of God. I want to talk from this simple thought, why pray? Why pray? With a few of your prayers, we want to just discuss for a moment why I pray. Are you ready? In this text, Jesus was praying. Now, for this text, the time and the scene or the date is discovered with exactness. And prayer, brothers and sisters, is the first note I want you to know, is not a scheduled event. Prayer is not predicated about it being done at the right time and in the right place. Prayer can be at any time, anywhere, and any place, watch this, and you never be out of order. Yet the historians do agree on one thing that is in this text, brothers and sisters, and that is Jesus understood prayer, and the historians all agree that when the disciples heard him praying, it was two things. It was aloud, and it was with amaze. Now, some people pray to put you to sleep. And Jesus talks about it in Matthew 5 of people who pray with vain repetitions. Matter of fact, anybody ever by show of hands been to a church and the deacon prayed the same prayer? And you picked up with it, "I'm body bound head." Y'all gonna talk to me? Right? Knee bent. And you was doing the same thing. You did the same thing every Sunday. But not this kind of prayer that Jesus prayed. It was aloud and it was with amaze. And the text confirms that the disciples, watch this, the beautiful part about prayer is meant to be heard. Now, what you need to understand about Jesus in St. Luke 11 is that he is our high priest under grace, just like in the old days they had a high priest that would go into the Holy of Holies. And it was something about the old priest that were in the holies of holies. Let's see what the scripture says. In 1 Kings chapter 8, verse 10 and 11, read it with me. "And it came to pass when the priests," this is Old Testament, "were come out of the holy place, that the cloud filled the house of the Lord." Verse 11 says, "So that the priests could not," what? "Stand to minister because of the cloud, for the glory of the Lord had," what? "Filled the house of the Lord." Look up for saints. It's my prayer that this month that you will begin to pray in your house. And it is my prayer that while you're praying in your house, that you will feel God's glory. For the house can feel it, you gotta feel it. And so watch this. If they were amazed and could not stand because of the glory cloud of the Old Testament under the old priests, what do you think the disciples felt and heard when they heard Jesus pray? I wish I could have been there. I can imagine what they must have heard and witnessed of Jesus, and that was his words and worship must have been supernatural. This is why you have to develop your own love language. Say that with me, I must develop my own love language. See, your love language is a language written from where? It's written from your heart. See, your heart is not what your mouth. See, your mouth put on airs when you with people. And don't you know your mouth can have one language and your heart have another? But brothers and sisters, when you have heart language, it's because it's apart and away from others. And how many know you have to develop this by yourself? Now, thank God you can read the Psalms, Mother Hannah, and pray the prayers of David. But watch this. There are no prayers like your own prayers. You have to write those prayers from your heart, Lexi. It can't come from anywhere. It comes from your experience. It comes from your trust in God. This is why Psalm 4, you're making a notation. 3 and 4 says it on this wise. Look on the screen, verse 3. But know that the Lord has set apart him that is godly for himself. Wait a minute. What makes me godly? What makes you godly is not you do everything right every day. The only thing that made David godly is that when he messed up, he kept coming to Jesus. Let me ask you this. When you mess up, where do you go? What makes you godly is that you need him and you keep coming to him. And it says, and the Lord will hear when I call him. How many know that your greatest blessing is not a car or a house or a Gucci suit, Gucci boots, and high tube socks? Your greatest blessing is that the Lord can hear you. Verse 4 says this. So when you know that what? Standing on and sin not. Commune where? Commune where? Talk church. Commune where? With your own heart. Where? Up on your bed. And what? Learn how to be still. Selah. Jesus had this kind of thing where he had communed with his heart. And can you imagine Mother Helen? And can you imagine Mother Mary when they saw Jesus praying, what they had to feel and what they must have saw when they saw him? And can I say this, brothers and sisters? For you to develop your love language from your heart, how many know this has to be something you do daily?
Yes.
Because words are spirit and God is spirit. Would you say that after me? Words are spirit and God is spirit. Say it again with power. Words are spirit and God is spirit. St. Luke 6 and 63 says it like this. It says, it is the spirit that quickeneth, and it is flesh that profit nothing. The words that I speak to you are what? They are spirit, and they are life. That's why Proverbs 18 and 21 teaches us, if you're making a note, it says, life and death is in what you say. Let me ask, you know, if I was preaching, I would say, well, why don't you talk much in church? It's because you don't have much communion in your heart. When you're in love with somebody, you don't have to find words. When you're in love with somebody, you go, well, I'm just trying to tell you, I got you the hamburger and everything, and I stopped by over there and then got you a pack of cigarettes, and then I'm just trying to tell you, I got some gas money there. You come up, I ain't gonna say anything. You come up with words because your heart is filled to communicate. Like you do with people, so much you must do with God. Let me survey the room and ask this question, Sister Blanche, and that is this. Has God done it enough for you to have an overflow of words with praise? I wonder what it felt like to be in the Lord's presence. I wonder what his spirit felt like. I'm sure it was gentle, would you agree? I'm sure when the disciples was listening, they felt a peace. I'm sure when he was praying, they felt compassion and a connection with God of heaven, and they felt a life-giving spirit. Anybody here, by show of hands, have some people in your life when you're around and you just feel like you are growing in life? You feel like your life is enriched. Anybody got people in your life you like hanging around because they speak positive words of affirmation? They say stuff like this. I know you're going through this, but you can make it. Watch this. If you don't have people in your life, get rid of the ones you do. Raise your right hand and say, Lord, I give you permission to invade my life with positive thinking people in Jesus' name. They focused on him, but they couldn't comprehend what he was doing with the prayer. And the reason why I say that is because they were so moved. Watch this. They didn't even write down anything Sister Kim Daddy said. It's not recorded anywhere what he prayed. They were just moved by how he prayed. And though you feel it, brothers and sisters, I'm sure they felt the power of prayer. Yet they did not record it. They wished to, listen to this, they wished to enact it. Anybody ever seen something that was so amazing you wanted to do it, you didn't care how they did? When I was sitting down with Jazzy just last night when I was in her room, and she was, "Daddy, come to my room, I want you to watch this show with me." Lolly Rock. He was watching Lolly Rock. And so Lolly Rock, about five of the girls, one got blue hair and yellow hair, and he was watching this. And so all of a sudden, Jazzy sitting next to me, and then Kurt, what she does, she jumps on top of the bed, and she starts to do her hands like this, and I'm looking at the TV, and looking at Jazz. She said, "Watch this, Daddy." And Lolly Rock jumped off and went to flying, and she jumped off the bed. Y'all know what I'm trying to do. She didn't understand flight, but because it moved her when she saw it, she wanted to fly. If you knew the power of prayer and what it would do for your life, you may not understand it, but you would want to enact it so that you can be a participant of that same power. And just sure say amen. Three things I'm out of your way. The first thing why you should pray is in the text, is share in togetherness. Share in togetherness. When you say that with me, share in togetherness. Togetherness is a state there on your screen of being close to another person or to be close to God. Look over, brothers and sisters, do you not know this is just what life is about? God gives you less than 100 years, that's if you make it down here, to discover one thing, how to talk to Him. To have some togetherness in it. And togetherness is a state of what? Being close to another person or being close to God. We pray because it brings us closer together with who? God and with man. Can I say this to you? Look up for brothers and sisters, and the reason why many of us don't have fruitful relationships are because those relationships don't have any prayer. There are people who live a lifetime together who have never prayed together. This is why the scripture says in the last day, when God starts rapturing up people sporadically, He says, "I'm going to take one in the bed and I'm going to leave one. One or two going to be gleaning in the field. I'm going to take one and I'm going to leave one." And the whole thing about it is, watch this, do you not know that you can live your whole life with somebody and that person have no relationship with God?
Yep.
Why sleep with somebody all those years and one of them ain't going to heaven?
Yee.
Brothers and sisters, God represents what? Let's look at it. God represents friendship. While having relationships with man represent what? Fellowship. You can't say you have friendship and not fellowship. And you can't say you got fellowship and don't have friendship. How can a man say he loved God whom he never seen? And despised of every brethren that he see every day? He said that man is alive, the truth of the Lord does not live in him. Say with me, God means what? Friendship. And man means what? How many got some relationships that people don't know how to talk to you? How well do those relationships go?
Not good.
They don't go too well. Are you with me? If it's like that with man, Sister Tina, then it's the same way with God. It don't go well. And what I want you to know, brothers and sisters, this is very difficult, but to pray like Jesus and hate your brother. Prayer keeps us reaching for God and reaching for fellow man. Do you hear what I'm telling you? You should be reaching for people. Not to scold them and mistreat. You should reach for them because God always reaches for you. Can I inventory the room and see, are there any grateful people that even when you didn't know how to reach for God, He yet reached for you? So prayer, why pray? It shares it together. Ain't nothing better than when you're going through somebody who knows you, reach for your hands to pray. Anybody ever been going through some trying times in your life and the phone rung and somebody said, "I just called to pray with you"? It breeds togetherness. The second thing, I'm almost done, it shields us from temptation. Temptation is mentioned 23 times in the Holy Scripture. 23, if you're looking there on your screen, it means it's a battle over your contentment. Say that with me, it's a battle over my contentment. Do you know what contentment means? Contentment means I'm happy. I don't need no more than what I have to be happy. I don't need you to do any more than what you're doing. I'm just happy. And what life does, it makes you compare. So somebody come along, you fine, you just got a dress. You got on clean underwear and socks. You continue. Until Sister Roosevelt came back. And she had on glitter boots. Y'all quiet. She had on Gucci purse. You saw it when you was window shopping, but you couldn't afford. Now all of a sudden you depressed internally, not thankful for the little dress you got from Kato's that you caught on clearance for $6.99. Thankful for the shoes you got from Payless that was two pair of shoes for $4.99. Now you gleaning in somebody else's field and you mad because you don't have the glittery boots and the purse that costs more than your rent.
Yee.
And life keeps coming, brothers and sisters, to make you discontent. And 23 is a battle of contention. So 23 times is the word temptation used. And it reminds us of Psalm 23. Psalm 23, David is going through and being tempted. And the prayers that he is praying, brothers and sisters, is that he discovered that when you're being tempted and you're having a fight over contentment, how many know this is what David said? And the Lord was with me. His rod and his staff comfort me. He leads me, he feeds me, and he supplies my needs. He anoints and appoints. He protects and brings all things into subjection. There are enough things in this life to try to make you discontent and get you off the pathway of righteousness. But how many know when you pray, it will keep your mind in perspective? See, when you pray, God will say stuff to you like this. Yeah, but you don't know all the hours of overtime they work. And they working all of them hours, ain't never home to raise their children. And their daughter is undercover homosexual. Sex texting with girls, and they have no clue. All they are caring about is wiping down that new truck. Y'all ain't gonna hear me now. See, if you pray, God will interpret some stuff that you see. Amen. Write down Psalm 73, read it when you get home, 12 through 14. Asaph said, when I saw how the wicked was doing well, it upset me. My foot almost slipped. He said, until I went in the house of the Lord and I understood that end. God interprets things at the house of prayer to help you. Matthew 26:41 says it like this. Read it with me. Watch and pray so you don't what? Enter into what? He goes on to say, for the spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. The last thing I want you to know, a while to pray is not only does it share it together, it's not only, brothers and sisters, does it shield us from temptation, I'm done. But watch this, it brings you in submission to trust God. Say that with me, it brings me into submission. Now, we don't like that word, but the key portion of submission is the word, write it down, sub. Anybody got a sub flow in your home? Nobody ever goes through the house and thank God for your subflow, do you? You just sweep across the ceramic tile and shampoo it and wash it and make sure it smells lovely and clean. But I bet you nobody this week when you was washing and cleaning that flow that it was clean. You said, Lord, I want to take a moment and thank God for the subflow. Let me tell you something. If you didn't have a subflow, you'll fall right through the flow. In other words, if you don't have a prayer life, you're going to fall right through situations. Sub has everything to read with to get under. I need to get under God. Beneath his wings, Psalm 91, his love abides. I mean, you know, in prayer sometimes you got to surrender because you're trying to tell God what you ain't going to do. I just need some real people out there. You telling God you're not going to change. You tell him what plans you have. And how many know God ain't going to hear nothing you say until you say nevertheless. Prayer is where you have to negotiate with your spirit to comply. God said, go in there and apologize to Lexi. I know what you said, but I ain't gonna apologize. And when your face threw it out.
Yes.
And the Lord make you sit right there in prayer till tears run down your face.
Yes, he will.
Do I have any witnesses out there?
Yes,
it's where prayer is where you come into agreement. All of that has to do with you submitting to what God wants you to do, brothers and sisters. And Jesus was not only devoted to the life of prayer, he was disciplined to the pain of prayer. Somebody say it with me, there's pain in prayer. You have to suffer yourself to submit. Nobody's will is in total agreement with God. What do you do when you asking God to get out of it and he says no? Stay in it. But Lord, you don't know they make me cry. You don't know they don't appreciate it. Stay right there. What do you mean stay right there? Stay there. My grace is sufficient for you. I'm too young to be dealing with this sickness in my body. Help me. Take this away.
from? No. When I quit the church, I'll never say your name again to nobody.
So Jeremiah said those words in Jeremiah 20. When he got still long enough, he says, the word is just like fire. Should have been my bones. I'm done. St. Luke 22 and 42. I'll close when I tell you. Jesus is closing out this passion because he's headed to the cross. It is something that he don't want to face. And he understands that some things in life when you don't want to face and you can't handle it, you have to take it to the Lord in prayer. He's negotiating with God, trying to get the bitter cup to be removed from him. But you know what, brothers and sisters? Are you looking? Mother Flossie, that's just some cups you got to drink. Anybody grew up with Castro?
Oh, yes.
Every summer, my grandma would make sure all the kids had a teaspoon of Castro. It was something about her calling us in there. We knew what it was. Micah! She would hold the cup over there. I said, I would say, oh, Lord. Can you put some honey in your grandma? She will always say this, and this is going to help somebody on our way out here. It don't taste good. But it's going to work. What's it going to do, Grandma? You got some mess in you that you don't know in you. So that's what prayer do. Prayer work your stomach up. Because you got some mess in you. And if you get a teaspoon of prayer, let me look down your road and say, don't take much of that castor oil, huh? A teaspoon to do me. Every head is bowed, Lord and gracious Father, we thank you for this lesson that teaches us to know why we should pray. Help us to share what heaven is doing on earth and what earth is in need of from heaven. Thank you. Somebody help me pray. Thank you. Today we learn why we should pray. That's the share. Did you feel the presence of God today? We were sharing and praying together. And I pray now, people going to be looking saying, you ain't caught it, you ain't got it, you bounce back from it. And you going to tell them, prayer shield me from some stuff. And the portion that we do not like about prayer is the thing that's going to keep us, and that is we must learn to submit, to trust God. Lord, I pray that you help us trust you under all circumstances. Watch this. That's not in our favor. In the name of Jesus. Amen.
Someone asked.
You said.
Someone asked the question.
Oh, glory. Why do we sing?
Why do we sing?
When we lift our hands.
When we lift our hands in Jesus.
Oh, what do we really mean?
What do we really mean?
Someone may be wondering.
Someone may be wondering.
When we sing our song,
when we sing our song,
at times we may
be crying,
and nothing's even wrong.
Nothing.